authority of Christ. I wonder where we're at right now. Can we just give God preeminence this morning? Can we make him first and foremost in our lives and in this service at this very moment? Heavenly Father, we exalt you today, God. We exalt you above all pride. We exalt you above every problem today, Jesus. Lord, we exalt you through every crisis, God. Lord, through every tear and through every tear of life today, God. Through every gain and every loss, we exalt you today, Jesus. We stand upon the right Christ, Jesus, that cannot be moved. We stand upon the promises of God, which are yea and amen. We stand, God, touched by this world, but we're not changed by this world. We may bear the scars of the past, but God, our hope for the future is greater, Jesus. Lord, we stand in the authority of Jesus Christ, and we declare the glory of God in this place today. Come on, clap your hands and give the God praise. Hallelujah.
There's freedom.
Come on, freedom reigns in this place.
Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
Yes, there is freedom reigns.
Freedom.
Second, third, we welcome you to CLC, Christian Life Center. Amen. We welcome you here. Amen. Everyone is thankful. Amen. What God is doing, a lot of folks are out. Amen. For the holidays, but you're here. Praise the Lord. And Jesus is here. Amen. The Lord is here. Hallelujah. So excited about what things are doing there. Hey, Sister Audrey, are you here? Amen. Praise the Lord. He sure is. Let me tell you, this woman, come on, I'll tell you what, come up here. Come up here, sis. Amen. This lady here, my personal assistant. Amen. Now, you're talking about dedication. Sis, no, I'm going to say, before you do what you're going to do there. I mean, look, if you ever wonder if you could do something for the Lord, amen, just think, wow, she is my personal assistant, works all the time during the week, and this is the only request she asks. If you can get me some more oxygen, I'll be here. Wow. I love you. Amen. And we're going to get you some oxygen. Amen. And maybe some of that nitrogen, too, there. The boots and the cars. And nitrous oxide. I like them jet cars. We love you, Sister Audrey. Amen. We had it. Yesterday we had our leadership meeting, and we had some gift cards to give away, and we forgot to pull the names. So I got all the names of everyone that was here yesterday, and we asked Sister Honest Audrey to pull the name there. Amen. And I think they all have my name on it, right? Oh, man. Too bad. Nancy Broussard, hospitality. Nancy Broussard, you was here. Amen, Sister Nancy. Hallelujah. Will you get some gift cards to the Roadhouse? Do you have the cards? You sure do. Here they are, $50 worth of gift cards. They are both for her. And I'm sure Ben's going to be helpful. Thank Ben's upstairs. Look at him. He's doing the... I ain't never seen you praise so much, son. Amen. He's getting the Holy Ghost up there. Thank you, Sister Nancy. Thank all of you. We had a wonderful meeting yesterday. A lot of folks, well, we had a great time. Amen. Next Sunday, I promise you, next Sunday is going to be great. We have Friend Day. And we are in production. We'll have the fun jump for the children. We have the outdoor. We have jambalaya. Brother Broussard and the crew is going to cook that jambalaya, white beans and sausage. And what a great opportunity to bring somebody, invite somebody to CLC. And they'll be able to find out that we are earthens. I don't know if they're human. Amen. They'll find out the other side. Amen. That people that come to church aren't all that crazy there, but we have another side. Just enjoy being one with another. So please take that opportunity to invite a friend or a family member, because we're gonna run a couple $1,000. We're not gonna ask nothing. It's free. The church puts it on. Amen. By faith, God's gonna pay the bills around here. Amen. Through your help. Amen. But let's waste that opportunity to invite someone. We're not looking for somebody that's going to another church. We're looking for somebody that does not go to church. Amen. Because he that wins a soul is wise. You never know. Everyone that gave their life to Jesus, amen, had to make that first step. Amen. They had to make that first step. And if you're the one that invites them, you never know what that first step may be. Hallelujah. A lot of times people don't want to go to church, but I'll go because you're going or because of this. Jesus says compel them. Go into the highways and whatever it takes, compel them. Convince them to come. Amen. You never know what that will do. Amen. Well, I thank you. Amen. I'm looking forward for a great time next week. Amen. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. And I would like to invite somebody up here. I know I'm going to catch him off guard there, but he has a little history around here. Chad and Dornetta. Amen. They live up there in the Pennsylvania. Brother Chad, I want you to come up here. Amen. He's starting to work up there. Up in Pennsylvania area there. His wife, Donetta, can you stand there? Beautiful voice is singing. Also, she sings. She's just works together. Thank you, Donetta, and their beautiful children. Chad, come on up here. I tell you what, just say a few words about, you know, his Father's Day. And me and him go way back there. So maybe he'll have a few kind words to say about me. Won't put me down too bad here today. Brother Chad.
Good to be in the house of the Lord on a Sunday afternoon. Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Hallelujah. Well, I am a little bit off guard, but that's not unexpected with Brother Mesh. Been knowing him for a while. Actually, when my wife and I first got married, the first church we attended outside of the state of Pennsylvania was this one. We were here when we were in the other place. Probably not many of you remember that building. Anybody? Oh, more than I expected, yes. And I remember when we were building this place, and I remember the many sleepless nights Brother Mesh had laying tile and finishing mud and doing all kind of stuff. And it's good to come back many years later and see that the work continues and to see that the gospel is still being preached. Amen. And still feel the sweet presence of God that can just flow in and interrupt our lives and bring healing and bring relief and deliverance into souls. Amen. I am so glad to see that still continuing here. I've got nothing but kind words for Pastor Mesh. He has been a big influence in my life. I shared with him the other night that one of the things I learned from him was love for people. Maybe you didn't hear me. See, that's something that we just hear. You probably just expect that and you're used to it, but you won't find love everywhere you go. Amen? To have a pastor that truly loves you and cares for you and wants to bring you in and wants to show you that's hard to find. And I learned that lesson from Brother Mesh, and I have continued that on in the ministry that God has blessed my wife and I with. And we do that each and every Sunday, just as he did and taught us how. And God is doing great things all across this great land. Amen. Can we give him a hand clap of praise? Amen. Hallelujah. I could go on and on, but time is short.
You know, I was going to get him to preach, but I knew he was on vacation. I know how it is with pastors. Amen. Get a vacation there. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Chad. Amen. And we are honored for y'all to be here. Amen. Very educated young man, too. I don't know, CEO, great corporation there. He worked for Chevron. He's I just highly respect him. And I watched him grow in the Lord. And very excited about your work there. And we'll keep you in our prayers down there. Amen. Well, if you could stand for the reading of the Word of the Lord, we'll just go right into that. I'm a little conscious. Today is Father's Day. And hopefully some of you will be able to go home. And if you know, my dad doesn't pray anymore. Amen. My dad is gone. Amen. And maybe if he does, he's praying in glory for me. Amen. Praise the Lord. But that was a great song, Brother Ken. If you really get to the understanding of the gist of that song. Amen. Take an opportunity if your father is here. Amen. To call him and go see him. And even if there's some outs, it's a great time. Amen. To make amends. Because sometimes it's... it doesn't always go the way we want. I tell you what, can I swap mics here, son? I'm swapped. Oh, there we go. And I'm going to cut this one off right here. Thank you. Praise the Lord. We had enough difficulty there. Amen. And he'll probably work out a couple of bugs. Well, if you have to read the Word and you'll stand, I tell you what, I'm not going to keep you standing because I want to read a whole lot of Scripture. So we'll just pray and you can be seated. Well, I apologize. Our computer is locking up. What can lock up is locking up except for me. Hopefully not my jaw. Hopefully that don't lock up on me. Amen. Praise the Lord. Maybe you might be praying for that, but please don't. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here today. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your word. We thank you, God. You know, Paul says, Lord, I will be therefore, lifting up holy hands without wrath or doubt. Why would Paul say that? Because we believe when we lift our hands, we're not angry and we're not bitter, but we believe that Jesus is here. God, you're a spirit. We can't see you, but thank God we can feel you. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for being here today and on this Father's Day, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would anoint me, Lord Jesus, to somehow give your people something to take home, something to spiritually be strengthened and encouraged in Jesus' name. Amen. And you can be seated. In the book of Luke, Luke writes, records some of the sayings of Jesus. Now, Jesus in Luke chapter 15, verse 1, I'm going to read from the King James Version. Jesus was sitting with publicans and sinners. And that's not Republicans and sinners. That's just publicans. Everyday common people. Verse 15, and they drew near unto him and the publicans and sinners for to hear Jesus or to hear him. And the Pharisees, the scribes, murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. So they're visualizing that Jesus is sitting with these people that don't go to church. They're not like us. The Pharisees were the religious people. Scribe, I don't know if you know what a scribe was. They were the one that recorded the word of the Lord. They would take the Old Testament, and that's all their job was, to scribe. And word for word and letter for letter, they mess up anything, they scratch it, start on. They were the very few people could write. They were the educated. They were the lawyers of its day. If there was a lawyer, actually oftentimes ministry came to be a physician for it in the law of the word. The Pharisees were the lawyers. They were the educated people. That's why they thought they knew everything, but really knew very few things concerning love and about the real thing about God. So they saw that, and they saw Jesus mixing with the sinners and the regular everyday people. And they said, this man receiveth sinners. and eatest with them. And Jesus spake this parable to them, saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, and if he was to lose one? Now, please catch the story of Jesus if you want to. And I don't, maybe you say, oh, wow, after you hear it, you may want to say, wow, I heard what Jesus said, that's good. I don't have to see what the preacher says, I'm gone. That's okay. But please catch what the Lord says on this day. He said, which man of you has 100 sheep? And if you lose one of them, does not go and leave the 99 and go into the wilderness, and he goes to, until he finds that lost one, until he finds it. And when he has found it, he lays it upon his shoulders, he rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together all his friends and his neighbors, and they say unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. And I say unto you, that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth. So he brings a story out about losing a sheep, and he said, hey, how many of you guys, and which sheep was very common, and to lose one and to go out leaving the 99, go and bring joy. He said, I want you should call your neighbors. Look, I found the one that was lost. And he said, then he relates that to heaven. And he said, now, how about this? He said, verse 8, either which women would have a piece or 10 pieces of silver and would lose one, does not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it. And when she has found it, she calls her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, I have found the piece that which was lost. Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repents. And then he said, a man had two sons, and the younger of them to his father said, father, give me the portion of my goods that falleth me. In other words, give me my inheritance. And he divided unto them, he had two sons, he divided them his living. And not many days the younger son gathered all together, and he took a journey into a far country, and there he wasted his substance with righteous living, party life, and just lived it up. And when he had spent everything, he arose, and there was a famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and he joined himself to the citizen of that country, and he did fill his belly with the husk that the swines ate or the pigs ate. He began so low that no man would even give unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hard servants my father's has bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise, I will go to my father. I will say unto him, father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called the son. Make me one of your hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was yet a far ways off, the father saw him and had compassion. And he ran and fell upon his neck, and he hugged him and he kissed him. And when the son said unto him, father, I am a sinner. I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said unto the servant, his servants, bring forth the best robe, put on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and we will eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and am alive. He was lost and is now found. And they began to be merry. Amen. I want to minister a few moments here today, and I recognize the time is how a son can bring joy to a father, and how a father can bring joy to a son. Amen. Heavenly Father, I ask you, Lord, once again, Lord, open our eyes to the word of the Lord. Let us see, Lord, what you would have us to see here today in your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the story of the prodigal son, no doubt, is probably one of the most preached sermon, maybe even on Father's Day, and it's a good reason. It probably should be, because it talks about the father and it talks about the son, and rightfully so. It's a great story. But oftentimes, I think people we lose the focus maybe on what the true intent of what the Lord meant it to be. So I don't know if I'll give you something new. You may have heard it this degree, the way I would may want to say it. But yet, when I look at it and I see on the prodigal son, I see about he lost his way. We know he lost his inheritance. He lost his statue of who he was. He became very depressed in his journey away from the Father. We preached about, because the parable talks about the young man that was in the Father's house. Now he became depressed. Everything what could go wrong in his life seemed to go wrong in his life. And I like to talk a little bit about the son, but yet a little bit more maybe also about the father in this picture. Because, see, we oftentimes see the whole story of the prodigal son, the son, and what happened when we get away from God. But yet at this same moment, there's sadness in the son because he has broken fellowship. And the story is the broken relationship, not only of a son, but a son and a father. And in today's life, there's parents here today, there's fathers, there's mothers also. But yet, when a son or a daughter is departed and there's a separation, that relationship, there's sadness on both, eventually will come to both parts. How many sleepless nights do you think the father was when his son had left? How many nights was it? Because the Bible says that he moved off into a far country. And he came to where, how many nights did he wonder, where is my son? There was no communication in his day, and even in today is communication oftentimes when children leave home or they depart from the parents' house and they want to be on their own. There's sleepless nights that go into the hearts of a parent wondering, where's my son at? You know, what's going on? Is he alive? Is he dead? Is he harmed? Does he have a place to sleep? This parable that we read, surely it's about the son, but it's really about a separation of the father and the son, how that sever and how that pain and how it caused a lot of pain. But yet, so when we see that story, I often wondered, why did the father give to the younger son his inheritance? Amen. He said, I want to give me my portion. Now, his inheritance normally should not came until the parent actually was deceased and gone. Why would he give him that portion? The Bible says when he asked of his, give me my portion, the Bible further said he gave, and I don't know if it's the King James Version, I didn't go into break it up, but he said, so he gave it unto them. So I don't know if he split, maybe he was that old, he says, okay, I'm going to split my inheritance, I'm going to split what I have, and I'm going to give to the older son, and I'm going to give my portion to the younger. Because he said he gave it unto them. Now, when we look at that, you know, why would he do that? Well, we have to remember this is a parable. This is something that Jesus was using as a talking point. This was a, you know, like we say, it was something like, okay, let me give you an analogy. Let me give you, it wasn't a real story. Now, it's something that they could relate to. He said, now let me give you a story. And so he begins to give us a story about two sons. What is this story about? This story about, let me show you something. Give me an earthly story, but I want you, eventually, I'm going to bring it to something spiritual. But God oftentimes has to bring us where we're sitting at and what we can relate to before he can really show you this spiritual analogy. And so what he really wanted, this young man, he said, I want to show you what some young people go through and how they think happiness is one thing, but it's really going to be another. So we find the story that he did give it to his, but so this, normally he would not have done that. But he said, let me show you what happens. And that's why I'd ask Dave about the youth to be here today. Young people, oftentimes they want to know, because see, in the father's house, there's rules. There's responsibilities. And I'll tell you right now, as a parent, raising your children, they need guidelines. They need rules, and they need something to live up to. And they're not going to like it. Now, on the behalf of the prodigal son, what is he looking for? Why does he want his money?
Why does he want it? He wants happiness. And he don't feel like he's happy. He don't feel like he's getting what he deserves in life. So he's looking for happiness. So in this picture, Jesus has given you young people an opportunity to see if you can go to your parents and say, Dad, I don't know how much money you got in the bank, but I want part of it. And if your father had $1 million and gave you $500,000 because you want to be happy, this parable shows in reality what happens when a child, he was the younger child. Notice the elder, if we want to look, had enough understanding and may have been around long enough to recognize, in my father's house, I got it made. Now, the younger, the immature, doesn't recognize that. I'm telling you, the toughest time of raising me as a pastor or a parent was my children when they were around 15. My daughter and my son. Great. I'm glad they're in church today. Amen. I hate to use my children, but I told my son after going, 10 years living for God, quit cursing, quit drinking, smoking, all this stuff. I looked at him one day. I said, son, you're 15 years old. I said, I've been living for God for 10 years. I ain't cursed one time in 10 years. And finally today you broke me and I cursed. I said, the devil couldn't do it. The world couldn't do it. My son made me curse. I said, something's not right with this picture. Like the guy that sells the lawnmower, the little boy wanted the bike. And he had his lawnmower, and the guy says, he's going by, and the guy says, man, I like that bike. He said, I'll trade you for that lawnmower. The little boy, give him the lawnmower. Little boy takes off on the bike. A little while later, he comes back by, and the guy is pulling that lawnmower. And he said, it won't start. He said, the young boy said, you got to curse at it. He said, oh, no, I'm a Christian. I don't curse. He said, you keep on pulling on it. Oh, don't look at me like, I can't believe the preacher said that. You hear more junk on TV, fornication, ungodly words. My God, you come to church? No. Some things will make you curse. Do we want to? No. 1,000 times no. I don't know when the last time I cursed either. Thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, son. You've been a good son. The prodigal son wanted happiness. So in the analogy that Jesus says, first of all, he wants to teach us joy. Remember what all the parables were beginning? Before he did the parable on the son, he did two other parables. And this one was the third one. But he was getting the point about, remember? He was talking about joy. He was talking about what brought joy not only to the person, but also in heaven. What brought joy to angels. What's going to bring joy to our Heavenly Father. He was talking about joy. So he brings out a parable. So he uses the young person, the son, and saying, that young person was looking for happiness. In the pursuit of happiness, he thought it was going to be away from the Father's house. So in the parable, he said, I'm going to show you if you got your way, young person, if you really got your way and you took from mom and dad and they gave you what you wanted, this is probably going to be the outcome. You're going to take it. You're going to get away from the Father's house. You're going to get away from those prayers. You're going to get away from that protection. It's like the old saying, you got what you wanted, but you lost what you had. You got what you wanted, but you lost. You know what? Let me tell you, when you move out of mom and dad's house, you think about, oh, I'm going to pay all these bills. Them electric bills are going to come in, that phone bill, that rent is going to come in. You can't wake up in the morning, oh, I want some milk and some cereal. No, I don't want that kind of cereal. Daddy, I want these Fruit Loops. Daddy will get, okay, Fruit Loops. Mom will get a Fruit Loops. Let me tell you, you get out of mama's house, there's a lot of things you recognize. They got all kind of stuff in there. They got fruit. They got all kind of food and this and that. The air conditioning, you set it on, you leave the doors open. Raise it up, born. How many of you heard that before? But you leave the door. But that's because you you don't realize how blessed you are sometimes. And I'm talking to young people. I'm not saying, but you think you want happiness, but in reality you have it. But sometimes you don't miss the water or the until the well goes dry. And so the young, he uses the young, this the parable of this young man, but when he is unhappy, because he leaves the way and he recognizes that he has left behind the father and all the blessings, suddenly in reality hits home, the Bible said, after he had spent everything that he had in the great party life that he has and the source and somehow that he only had so much, he wasn't making it, and it was just all going out. Eventually he ran out. And Jesus also brings the reality of in the world, and no one gave him nothing. You get out, you can get broke at home, and mom and dad will help you out. But in the world, young people, I'll tell you, when you get down and out, and when you get down, the world's not going to help you out. They'll kick you down even further. Amen. So we find now a young man that was seeking happiness, we find that he's very unhappy. And at the same time, that unhappiness also, we had an unhappy parent. We had a father that's weeping at night, wondering, where's my son? The son can't perceive this. The son is so far off, he don't even feel the pain of his father. He don't even feel the, because he's to himself. The Bible finally says he came to himself, not understanding his father, not even remembering how much his father loved him, to where he's able to come back, though. And here's the reality sometimes. Jesus said, now this young man came to himself, and he said, I'll become as a servant. And sometimes that's the best way when you want to really come to the Father that loves you, come with a servant's attitude. Not what my church can do for me, but what can I do for the church? As JFK would say, not what I could do, my country can do for me, but what can I do for my country? We ought to come with that same thing. Not what can, too many, I pastored a long time and so many people would come to church and they would say, oh, what can the church do for me? What could the church do for me? I'm finally seeing something come in. I'm seeing a group of young people. We have more laborers coming to the church now and saying, Pastor, what can I do for the church? And I give you high five. Thank you. There's something. But you know what? Most of you have been out there and you have been prodigal sons and daughters, you have found out it ain't fun out there, and whenever you get down and out, they ain't nobody wants to help you. But if you come to the church and you do get down and out, the church is your friend, your church will help you. But you come with a service attitude. First of all, what can I do for my church? What can I do for my God? Not what God can do for me. First of all, come, what can I do for you, Lord? And God knows and sees that servant heart. And you talk about brought joy to this son. What brought joy? When that son came home, including when that son was coming home, notice this, fathers, and I was preaching to the sons, now I'm going to preach to the fathers. Fathers, let me tell you what the true father did. He didn't do. He didn't go where his son was at. He did not go. You can't lower your standards for your children. You have to stand your ground. You have to be something that's solid. You have to stand your ground. Oh, it hurts, but you stand and you stay and you pray and you believe God. And as the Bible said, the Father, amen, he saw him a far ways off. The Father was praying for him. He was looking for him, but he didn't go where he was. I'm not going to smoke dope with you because you smoke dope. I'm not going to join with you because you're going. I'm going to stand my ground, and I'm going to be the example I'm supposed to be. Someone has to stand their ground. Because you can't win them like that. You can't be where they're at. And you want to bring joy to your family, stand your ground. Because whenever you stand your ground, you're that focus. It's like, what's so good about a compass? And what's so good about a compass is whenever someone's lost, what's so valuable about a compass? Because no matter where you're at, that needle, it always points north. Now, I don't know if most of you probably don't even know how to use a compass. Some of you do. But a compass, you spin it around, it'll go east, west. It just spins around. But the needle is magnetic, and it always points north. So when you're holding your hand and say, if right now the needle is pointing there and it's showing you east, you turn the compass, and the needle stays there until it points north. Until north lines up with the needle. You spin it. And when north lines up with the needle, then you say, wow, that's north. And then you know where east and west and south is. It's that simple. But you know what? North is always there. The needle always, the father always is on the spot. No matter where a lost son or daughter is, the father and the mother and the parents got to be on location, that the son, no matter where they're at, that they always find, I can go to my father's house. I know there's love over there. I know he's not going to mistreat me. I don't care. I come with a service attitude. But you know what blew his mind? Is what his father didn't never want to make him a servant. His father had so much joy when he saw his, he said, go get the best calf, get the best thing. I'm telling you what, the mentality, what was it we have here today? Jesus was talking all the way. You want to bring joy in heaven? You want to make God happy? Just come back to where he is. You want to get happy? Come back to the Father. Hallelujah, because whenever you get together, whenever the father and the son, when the daughter and the father is truly back together, there is joy. Now, God loves church today, and God is glad we're all here. And next Sunday, God's going to be glad, I think, if we pack the house. But you know what's going to really, and not that he don't love none of us anymore, but I'm telling you, you know what, God, you know why God's not happy today? I don't care how much we put here. You know what's going to make him happy? That you bring one sinner. All heaven over one soul. He said, Jesus said, he started out with the thing. I don't care if you have 99 sheep. I don't know. You ever lost anything lately? I might have $50,000 in an account somewhere in my account. I lost $1,500 the other day. A guy gave me $1,500. I misplaced it. I don't know. Misplaced it. I'm getting old. I put the thing out. But you know what? Out of all the money I got, that $1,500, I'm not joyful. Someone gave me $1,500 and I can't have it. Compared to what I have, it's really nothing. But you know what bring me joy? I find that $1,500. I don't know about you. You lose a $20 bill and you might have $200 in your wallet, but if you lose a $20 bill, what brings you joy? It's when you find something that you lost, Jesus said. I don't care how much the house is, I'm going to tell you right now, you want to bring your pastor joy? You want to bring your co-pastor joy? Everybody wants to know, hey, what's Brother Lane? Well, you know how they have a pilot and a co-pilot? A pastor and a co-pastor. Amen. The pilot flies the plane. He gives instruction to the co-pilot, and the co-pilot says, okay, but if something happens, the pilot has to go to the bathroom, or he got to take a vacation, the co-pilot can fly the plane. It's that easy. Hopefully, for as long as I'm around, there'll be a pilot and a co-pilot. And maybe I'll get seen now when y'all say, Pastor Mitch, put that co-pilot in there. And I'll just sit there, and I'll be able to give him some instructions. Thank you, Brother Lane. You want to make me, your pastors, happy? What is it? You want to make heaven happy? I'm challenging you. You want to bring joy? Is seek out he that winneth a soul with wise. That's all I'm asking. Because Jesus said, I don't care how many saved people come to church next Sunday. The only thing that's really going to make him happy next Sunday, I mean, he shows up, he's going to be glad I show up. He's going to be glad. But he expects that. You know what's going to make God happy? Is that I invite someone that's not going to church and I get me a sinner over here. And I'm talking about all heaven's going to rejoice. Amen. That you invite somebody. So I'm challenging you right now. I'm challenging you right now. But listen, did it bring the son happiness when he found the father? It made the father happy when he found the son. So it goes both ways. If we bring somebody to meet the father, we're going to put happiness in their life, and we're going to make the father happy. And if the father is happy, everybody's happy. I don't know about you. I want to make God happy every week. Now, you know what? You could be here today, and you could be lost. spiritually speaking. I say separated from God. Amen. How can you make God happy today, your father? How? Amen. It's a personal thing, you know. Relationship with God is a personal thing. And on Father's Day, the most perfect father. How can we make the most perfect father? I had a great father. Amen. He wasn't perfect. Amen. But he was a great father. But you know what? The most perfect father I got is my heavenly father. And the Bible says, and we have to understand, the first Adam was earthly. The second Adam was spiritually. Now, my first Adam, my first father, did things for me for earthly. My second father, which is Jesus Christ, does for me spiritually. My first father couldn't do what my second father can do. Amen. So I'm saying, I made my first father happy. And we stayed together. We were friends. It's time. How about pleasing that spiritual father? Amen. Do you really want happiness? Like I said, if you're away from the Father and you're seeking happiness away from him, it's not going to happen. That's why Jesus did the analogy. That's why he did the parable. I'm telling you, happiness, true happiness is found not only when you have your physical, but you have your spiritual. You are made up. The Bible says we are to have the natural man and we have the spiritual. I'm sorry to say every one of us has a natural side and a spiritual side. You may fulfill all of your natural ability. You may have the nicest car, the nice home, and all the things of the world. That's not going to give you total happiness. Total happiness is when you fulfill the soul. When you connect with that heavenly Father and you finally say, Father, I've been away from you. I had a lot of things in the world. I separated. When you connect with the Father, you're talking about you're going to be happy and he's going to be happy and there's going to be a party going to happen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Can we stand on our feet? Amen. I want somebody to bring happiness to God, but I want you to find happiness. I want you to find happiness, because when you come back to the Father in the way that you should be, how about your first love? Sometimes Christians, we're like the younger. We like the younger son. We think happiness, and it's a trick of the adversary that separates us from the Father, and we get separated, and before you know it, we find ourselves, and then we find out, well, it ain't as good as I thought. When we come back to God and the Father's house and he's all excited and he's forgiven us, he don't make us, okay, you got to do all these chores to make up. No. The grace of God, it's like it never happened. The devil can't come. The devil said, no, you need to be a servant. No, God said, no, you're a son, you're a daughter. Just because, I don't care how far you strayed, when you come back home, it's like it never happened. In Jesus' name. Families could gather around the altar before we leave and they sing unto the Lord. Amen. Can we make a fresh commitment, this whole church, and maybe think about somebody that is lost, someone that used to come to church, someone maybe used to go to another church, or maybe someone has never gone to church. What if you could bring joy in their life? What if you could invite them? Amen. Brother Chad, my good friend, his son locked the keys in the car the other day. We just calmed. I didn't get been out of shape. We ended up calling Papa Lock. And after the Papa Lock guy got here, I got to talking to him. And I found out, you know, he hadn't been going to church. Immediately, I said, well, look, I'd love to invite you to church. He had a bad experience. I said, well, look, I had some bad experiences in church. I said, we hope to establish. CLC is built upon love. We're not gonna force you to do nothing around here. It's a volunteer army. I don't get on you. You can miss church. You can join a ministry and don't make it. I'm not gonna get mad at you. I'm just saying, wow. If you want to be a part, it's a volunteer army. You know, because we want you to do it because you want to, because you have to. And I said, well, look, I invited him there because to me, it's an opportunity. Every time we see somebody, huh? We all should have Christian Life Center cards. Not because here, but meet somebody. And either give my, I usually tell them, hey, look, either come here or go find your church. It's too close to the end of time, church. It's too close to the end that we don't invite somebody. And people are looking for happiness. And sometimes they're so far away that they think, well, I'm too bad to be good. You don't have to get good to get God. You don't have to get good to get God. Get God and you'll get good. You'll want to get good. You'll want to please the Father. You'll be so glad. Wow, I can't believe he didn't make me pay my debt. Amen. I'm like as Apostle Paul. I'm chief among sinners. Amen. I never will be able to pay my debt of my sin that I did. But you know what? Jesus, I believe in the blood of Jesus Christ that he washed it all and it's gone. I'm happy. Amen. Because I don't have to work my salvation. My salvation is by his grace. Am I going to just sin because God? No. I'm going to try to stay as far as I can away from that. Amen. And I'm closing with it on saying that. Listen. I'm reminded of a story of a queen, and she was looking for a stagecoach driver. And she started interviewing, and this one guy came and he said, Queen, he said, I'm going to get a stagecoach. I get a team of 12 horses. And he said, I could come within 6 foot of the edge of that cliff, and you're safe with me. Wow. Next interview, then next guy. He said, Queen, let me tell you, I could take a team of 12 horses in your stagecoach and you in there, and I could come within 1 foot, and you're safe with me. Finally, the last man came up, interviewed for the job. He said, Queen, when you're in my stagecoach, I'm going to stay as far as I can from the edge of that cliff. You're going to be safe with me. Church, the moral of the story is not seeing how close we can be out there and still be safe with God. The moral is try to stay as far as him, because flesh is going to pull you further. It's going to want to take you further than you want to go, make you pay more than you want to pay, and stay longer than you want to stay. That's the old trick of the adversary. Come to God and give everything you can to him. Amen. Can we lift our hands? Pray one with another, fathers, husbands, wives. Pray one for another. If your children are out of church, and if your dad or your mom's out of church, sometimes it's children inviting parents, and sometimes it's parents inviting children. Amen. But let's make them happy. Let's make God happy. Let's be a happy church. Amen. In Jesus' name. Let's sing it to
before
the
Lord. Before we do anything, amen. I want to see, see this right here? Y'all know what these are? Those are mints.
Amen.
This is a vehicle for ministry right here. Believe it or not. Yeah, I want to tell you, right after we finished praising and worshiping, before the sermon started, that I ran to that store right there, right next door. And the little girl that works there was walking out with someone, another girl. And so I walked in there and grabbed this, and she walked back in the store and says, how you doing today? I said, I'm doing great. How are you? She said, you coming from church? I said, yes, I am. She said, pray for me.
Oh, Jesus.
And she turned her back and she was going behind the counter. I said, I'll do it right now.
Hallelujah.
No one was in there. So she stopped and I went up to her and I just gave her a big old bear hug and I said, I love you. I said, God loves you. I said, he wants you to love yourself. And I said, he wants to spend time with you. And I said, he gave everything for us. And all he wants is just us to give back to him. And she said, I'm glad you came through here today. She said, I know you came in here for me. I said, that's the right attitude. That's good. That little meeting right there, I don't know what God's going to do in her life. I don't know what he's doing right now. But you know what? For her to say, pray for me, that's bold. And it was all because of this right here. It's a small thing. It's a small thing, but she's huge to the Lord. Her life is important. Her soul is important. So anyway, it's just an example of how God uses us. And we don't even really know how many times he uses us like that throughout our lives and our Christian walk. We just have to be obedient.
Amen.
And don't be scared to hug somebody you don't know and to pray for them.
Amen.
Amen.
And invite them to church.
Spirit of the Lord is.
We lift our hands up.
There is freedom.
Say it.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. If you're tired, come on, church. If you're tired and you are thirsty, there is freedom. If you're tired and you are thirsty, there is freedom. Freedom reigns in this place. Freedom reigns.
Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Before we leave, I want everyone right now to think about someone that you wish was here. Someone that is straight. I'm talking about somebody that is down and out. They feel like the world has, they have failed the world. They fail, and the world has failed them. You know, the Lord would tell us right now, I'm telling you, if we will take the ones that nobody wants, I said, if we'll welcome the ones that nobody wants, God says, I'll give you the ones that everybody wants. Come on now. We need to look for somebody that's down and out, and they haven't been to church in a long time, and they feel like they're unworthy and unwanted, and nobody loves them. Their life is a wreck. You need to invite them and say, you know what? I'm going to give you, man, come to church with me. I don't care if they, how they come, just get them here. And let's see what Jesus has for them next week. Amen. That they could put joy back in their life and that they could put joy in the Father's life. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Turn around and shake hands with someone and tell them how good it is to be here. Look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, musicians, singers, worshipers.